I'm covering for Jeff again today, and it looks like I probably am going to be in here on Friday enjoying everyone's smiling faces on this. So again, I answer to Carl. What I'd like to do is pick up with the beginning of virtual memory. And if I could have one conversation, that would be great. Danke. Actually, that's an example of time multiplexing. Right? In other words, one person at a time in the room. Anyway, what we're going to be talking about is kind of a quick recap of scheduling, with the caveat that I am very rusty with the swirly staircase thing of a bob. But then go on from that, we're going to be talking about the introduction to virtual memory and kind of talk about some of the justifications for why we have this whole virtual memory apparatus. In other words, why can't we simply get away with not having it? And let's talk about some of the problems that result from that. And kind of leave the class with an introduction to some of the goals that Jeff's going to be talking about in subsequent classes as to how we can have an efficient and, well, effective virtual memory system on that. As you probably know, this is going to be, if you will, the end part of the last part of the project in the class. This is assignment 3, is essentially to write a memory manager from the ground up. It's a big project, but I can also tell you it's a fun project. So once you get through assignment 2 in one sense, the assignment gets bigger, but it's also more rewarding on that sense. So you can kind of get a sense for, well, how, if you will, memory gets shared, multiplexed, and you're actually the one that are going to be designing the policies and enforcement procedures for the user processes when they're out there and they decide to misbehave on that. So, problems with direct physical allocation, well, actually, you know, before we get to this, kind of, oh yes, announcements.txt. I think this is where last year Jeff talked a little bit about pacing for assignment number 2. Again, assignment number 2, checkpoint 2.2, the rest of it is going to be due next Friday. That is creeping up on that. In terms of pacing, I would suggest for most people you should be just about done with fork and working on wait if you have not done so already. I assume people are done with the file syscalls. If you're not, you really are behind the 8-ball on that. As far as the process syscalls, a kind of a good pacing is fork for about maybe 3-4 days or so. It's a big one. Then wait PID, maybe a couple days. Execv, about maybe 3-4 days or so. Wait PID, get PID, all of them maybe about 2 minutes. And you know, that's the one where you want some, again, affirmation, and you know, you want some positive reinforcement. You know you can knock out get PID right away. And then I'd allow a few days at the end for things like going over cleanup, inevitable bugs. You're going to need to make sure that everything ties in with your file system on that. And again, one of the reasons I am trying to push this is obviously next week is probably going to be high time for midterms projects and other classes and whatnot. So again, the sooner you can get this done, the better it is with that. Midterm coming up the week after spring break on that. We do look to hopefully have some review sessions coming up for you people on that, followed by the first checkpoint for assignment number 3 1 week after that. The first checkpoint for assignment number 3 is a relatively small one, but again, just you don't want to kind of let it flop off of your scheduling calendar on that. So questions about kind of the pacing, the assignments, what have you? Again. Okay. We're seeing a lot of the same faces in office hours, which is good and bad. That's what office hours are for. Use them. Okay, so for those of you who are strangers, don't be strange. The sooner you can unstrange yourself, the better it's going to be for everyone concerned on this. All right, scheduling goals here. What is the purpose of goals? Again, to recapitulate on this, well, we want something that works on here. So in other words, number one, we want to meet deadlines. We don't want to starve things out. So just because there is one thing that's a priority, we don't want to make sure that the things that are not priorities eventually just fall off the face of the earth. That said, we also want to make sure that things that are priorities get prioritized ahead over things that are less so on this. Okay, resource allocation. This is a general trend again in this class. You want to make sure that things are not, if you will, twiddling your silicon thumbs on this. So we want to use the scheduling policies to ensure that the CPU is booked as much as possible, the disk drive is booked as much as possible, that we're responsive to the user. Obviously, these are conflicting goals, but that's one of the aims of the scheduler, is to try to sort out these conflicting goals. And of course, the last thing here, performance on this. And I know Jeff is big about talking about the fact that performance itself takes a hit. In other words, if we have a scheduler that's trying to implement, let's say, a nice QT algorithm, but it itself takes so long to figure out that QT algorithm, it's not very good on that. So we want to make sure that a scheduler makes smart decisions, but it doesn't unduly impact the performance of the system on that. Okay, oh, and obviously the big one, one of the biggest things is don't keep people waiting. You can keep silicon waiting over people. Okay, now, in terms of types of schedulers that are out there, there's a whole bunch of them, and you kind of get the feeling after a while that it's a case of trying to build a better mousetrap on that. We start off with the simple ones. In other words, let's just pick something at random. Okay, we could certainly do that. Or another one, probably looked at this. Has anyone looked at, I know some of you have, but have you looked at the scheduling algorithm in OS 161? Yeah, I mean, what does it do? It says, in effect, grab the next one off of the queue, okay, and just kind of keep cycling it through. Essentially, schedule does squat, nothing on this. It's simple, it works. It's perhaps not very efficient under heavy loads or special circumstances, but it at least, well, it's simple. And again, on a didactic operating system, that's perhaps exactly what the doctor ordered. But let's see if we can't do a little bit better than simply, if you will, a know-nothing. Let's maybe, can we throw maybe a few IQ points at maybe making a better selection about which thread to schedule and in what order on this? So know-it-all is if we are omniscient, we have our Swami's hat on, and we know exactly what is coming up in the future, well then in that case, we can presumably make a lot better decisions. In other words, if I know for sure that thread X is about to block, well, you know what, I might as well schedule that, because remember of one of these, if you will, OS imperatives, something that is going to block on, let's say it needs IO from the disk, let's get that blocking process started fast for two reasons. Number one is the blocking itself. We start it and it immediately blocks. We can now use the CPU for something else. But the other thing too is the sooner we get the blocking process to get the disk drive circuitry spinning and doing its wizardry, the better on that too. So if we know that a process is about to block, let's start that blocking process ASAP on that. Similarly, if we know a particular process, it has to run some computations in order to produce, let's say, a pretty graph or, let's say, a picture of an angry bird dying on a screen for the purpose of the user, we want to probably run that quickly too, because that's something that will in some way impact a user experience. So again, the more we know about the future, the smarter scheduling decisions we can make, the user will be happy, et cetera, on this. That's great, again, assuming that we have our Swami's hat on and we have a perfect view of the future on this. Now, in practice here, what are some of the decisions that's going on here? How long is it going to be using the CPU? Will it block or yield? Or how long will it wait on here? Again, these are all factors that need to be considered. With me on this so far? So, okay, now the problem is, can we predict the future? Well, we're not Swamis, but maybe we can, at the very least, instead of knowing the future for sure, make good guesses about the future on this. And this is where, let's say, Jeff is talking about using the past to predict the future. Kind of you hear if you follow like financial investing. Okay, past performance is not entirely indicative of future results on that whenever some stockbroker is trying to sell you some financial investing scheme. Well, the thing is, it's not completely predictive. Otherwise, you know what? We would already know what the stock market is going to do next year, and essentially decisions would already have been made. But at least past performance does give us some indication as to what's going on. We're going to do the same thing here. In other words, if a thread blocked a lot in the past, there's a good chance that it might block a lot in the future, et cetera, on this. So what we're trying to say here is a dumb schedule that knows nothing is easy to implement. But let's be a little bit smarter than that. Okay? If the more we know about the future, then the better scheduling decisions we can make. Now, unfortunately, we don't know the future, but we can take guesses about the future. And that is, we're talking about using the past to predict the future. And let's look at a couple examples of this here. Multi-level feedback queue. Again, that's essentially a thing where we have, well, a bunch of queues here. And remember, we're going to reward, if you will, threads that block a lot by kind of keeping them on the high priority queues and vice versa on that. Those that, let's say, churn through lots of numerical computations, we're going to kind of bottom them down in terms of priority on that. And then, actually, the other one is, did Jeff called it like the BF scheduler on this? Did he talk to you guys about that? Okay, okay. The swirly staircase and then the anesthetist. Okay, all that. Yes. Okay, which I think that's the next slide on that. Again, another attempt at, if you will, using, if you will, smart decisions to come up with what's coming up. Now, a couple people here just in terms of line scheduling. By the way, this is the sort of thing that you will probably want to know for like multiple choice questions on the test here. But like Ingo Molnar, do you remember the, if you will, Linux scheduling wizard? And this con is it, I forget, is it Austrian or Australian? I think it is. Okay, it was Australian. Okay, okay. Yeah, but the doctor who spent half his life trying to reinvent the mousetrap on here. So, and rotating staircase, which I will not attempt to explain except only superficially on here. We have an example of, let's say, all these different levels of priority here, and Jeff is an example, I'm sorry, asking is an example. Let's say that we have, let's say, something that is all the way down at the second to lowest priority schedule, and we've got three threads on 0, 3, and 7. Well, essentially, what's the worst case scenario? Well, you can take the time quantum for each of those three ahead, just multiply it out, and we get our answer of 15 milliseconds on this. Something like this might show up in maybe one of the short answers where he might ask you, let's say, to do a little bit of computations or something like that. So, questions about scheduling? Going once, going twice. Sold. Okay. Okay. And I can assure you, if Jeff could be here today, he would. He really does love virtual memory. It is a cool topic. I will agree with that. So he will at least be in here on Wednesday to kind of reintroduce the next step in the process here. So let's talk a little bit about space versus time multiplexing. Again, you probably encountered this if you took 341. It's very closely, if you will, allied with the concept of, if you will, spatial versus temporal parallelism. But in essence here, time multiplexing, again, this is the thing about, this is the classic CPU thing, where we have one CPU being chased by a whole bunch of threads, and we need to kind of divvy that CPU's up among threads according to what? According to time on this. So it's kind of like, again, right now, I'm speaking, but if one of you has a question, I have to shut up so that you can communicate. So in essence, only one person can be on deck at any one time. Because if you don't, what happens is you get what? You can't hear what's going on. Let's actually go back to that analog in just a minute here. Okay, so CPU scheduling, room scheduling, again, because there was, I believe it's distributed in here before, and now there's 421 in here today, and then who knows what's going to be in here after this. I don't know art history or what have you. But the upshot is that we are dividing things up according to time, over time here. And this is what we talk about when we're talking about concurrency, if you will, that multiple things happen over a block of time. As distinguished from, if you will, space multiplexing, this could actually involve things, multiple things happening simultaneously. But in order to do that, we have to divide it into smaller pieces on this. And again, an example of that is CPU scheduling on multi-core systems, because what's going on here is, let's say that I have four CPUs, okay, well, I can kind of multiplex things spatially by running four things simultaneously at an instantaneous point in time. However, those four things only get a quarter of the resources on that. An analog to that is, again, right now I'm speaking to the entire room. Okay, if one of you wants to ask a question, okay, I have to yield the floor for the entire room. But let's say we could divide this up into, let's say, several subgroups, okay? And let's say you people do a sub-discussion on this. So now we have several sub-discussions that are going on simultaneously, but at the cost of what? You don't get the entire floor to yourself. You only get part of the room. With me on the distinction here between temporal versus spatial multiplexing here. So, okay, other examples here, memory management. Oh, I should say, when we're talking about low and high granularity here, we're simply talking about, like, with CPU scheduling, the quanta typically are very, very teensy-tiny in terms of CPUs, as opposed to when we're talking about memory, we're talking about, if you will, much bigger chunks here. Now, when I'm talking about memory management in terms of spatial multiplexing, a crude way to think about it is your computer has, who knows, let's say 4 gigabytes of RAM. and let's say that you're running a whole bunch of processes. Well, we know in terms of the CPU, okay, the CPU, let's say, and let's just say for simplicity's sake, you have a 15-year-old computer that has only one core. Well, that CPU can only run one thing at a time. Hence, again, time multiplexing. In terms of memory, how about that 4 gigabytes? Are we talking about giving all 4 gigabytes to one thread, and then all 4 gigabytes to another thread, and then all 4 gigabytes to yet another thread? No, of course not, because you probably have pulled up like Process Manager or whatever it is in Mac, and you can see how much memory is allocated to each thingamabob. So in other words, we multiplex memory in terms of space. You get this chunk, you get this chunk, you get this chunk. And I should say I'm being a little bit sloppy when I say chunk, because in terms of like the underlying physical memory, it's very often chunked. But again, this is what Jeff is going to be talking about in terms of virtualization. It very often appears that it's not chunked. That's kind of some of the magic on that. But for now, if you think about it in terms of practice, like in terms of the underlying physical memory, this is actually a very good way of thinking about it. Because let's say Internet Explorer might be, given this area of, the first 10 megabytes, then who knows, Mosaic might be given the next 20 megabytes, and then who knows, Netscape Navigator might be given the next 30 megabytes, because we're kind of playing with really old and obsolete web browsers. All righty. Questions, comments, complaints, spatial versus temporal multiplexing. All right, memory allocation here. Okay, this is kind of from a programmatic viewpoint here. Let's say that my program is running and I need a bunch of memory here. Now, actually what goes on, let me start at the bottom here and go back, or actually start with number 2 and work back up. You probably know that let's say I need a clutch of memory I want to declare an array or something like that. I'm going to call the malloc function. And malloc is, strictly speaking, a user-level function. It's implemented in library. I don't know if you remember me talking 2 weeks ago, but crudely speaking, there are 3 levels in a computer. There are user-level applications, there's library code, and then there's kernel. Okay, the top 2, if you will, applications and library, those are both user-level. Right. Even though we often think of, let's say, only the application as being user, but the library code is also run in user mode or unprivileged mode. And then the bottom one is, if you will, the kernel itself. Well, malloc is a function that, if you will, exists in user land. And essentially what it does is, if I say I need 100 bytes, it says, here you go. Here's 100 bytes. And by the way, what else does it say? What does it return? It returns a, you've used it. I'm sorry? Yes, starting, because I need to know where that is, right? And if you're thinking about this, there's this voodoo magic going on in the background. How does it know where to get that address? Well, that's actually one of the nice things about how malloc works, and this is what Jeff is alluding to here. I know at a lot of universities, it's a project of like a software level systems course, write malloc. And it's your job to kind of come up with cool algorithms to, if you will, divide up memory efficiently, avoid things like fragmentation and whatnot. Okay, but where does malloc get its memory? Back to the top one here. I say I want 10 bytes, or I want 100 bytes, or whatever else. Malloc is very flexible in that. All right. But if you look underneath the hood, and you already have an example in front of you in terms of OS 161, take a look at kmalloc, and you don't have to look at all the gory details. Your eyes will glaze over and your head will drop off if you look over it for more than 5 minutes. Okay, but eventually, kmalloc will make a call to a subroutine, if you will, which, what is it in user get ksegs? I forget the, what is that? Oh, get ppages. I'm sorry, get? Okay, well, what's the one above that? It's, okay, well, anyway, I forget, okay. Anyway, the upshot is that there is a function that kmalloc calls to get memories in slabs, if you will. Or in the case of OS 161, it gets it in terms of 4K chunks on that. So, and that's something that at the, if you will, user level, okay, well, malloc actually calls down to the operating system, and it uses typically the syscall, either sbreak or mmap on that. You're going to be implementing sbreak as part of assignment number 3. But even within the kernel, you can see there's a kernel analog to sbreak called, again, well, it eventually boils down to get ppages on this. And that's actually what you're going to be doing is implementing as part of assignment 3.1. So, but the upshot is, how do we actually go about getting memory here? A user-level program asks for essentially a flexible number of bytes from something like malloc, and malloc in turn calls down to the operating system, and the operating system makes more voodoo happen, but in terms of typically larger chunks that are fixed in size on this. In other words, all the operating system cares about is the principle. Here you go, here's a chunk. I don't want to be bothered with the details of how you use that. I'm concerned with things with security and enforcement and whatnot. You at the higher levels can fiddle around with, if you will, 10 bytes, 15 bytes, or whatever your magic number happens to be. All right, now, remember I had promised at the beginning of class that one of the main motivations of this class is, why do we have memory managers in the first place? In other words, why, you know, if you think about it, assignment 3, it's going to be a pain to implement. I do promise you will learn a lot, and you will actually learn to love it in the end if you're warped like me and a few other people on this. But the thing is that it's a pain to implement. So why do we go through this? Okay, is it because we're masochists? I guess that's one explanation. But maybe there are some other explanations here. Maybe there's a problem with not doing that. So let's take a look at what might happen without, if you will, a memory manager on here. In other words, let's talk about, if you will, direct physical memory multiplexing on this. So let's just divide memory in between processes on this. So in other words, we've got this huge blotch of memory here, and let's say that I have one process and it's using one piece of memory, and I assign another process to another piece of, and you get the idea here. All right, very simple on this. And indeed, that does work. So in other words, we don't need a memory manager. Well, it works, again, as long as there's some caveats that we're going to get into in just a sec here. Problems with this here. Okay, we used up this amount, and we're kind of getting to close to the end here, which already highlights one of our problems. If we're dealing with memory in terms of, if you will, the direct physical memory. Oh, let me digress for just a moment. Physical. What do we mean by physical? You're going to hear the terms physical versus virtual bounced around a lot for essentially the rest of the semester here. Quickie version is that when we're talking about physical memory, we're talking about the stuff in, if you will, the RAM chips, okay? The SDRAM chips, the dynamic, in other words, the things, you know, when you pop one of those memory stick thingamabobs into or out of your computer, or hot swap it, if you will, okay? So that is what we mean by physical memory. And when we're talking about a physical address, we're talking about the number that appears on the address bus to the memory chips, okay? The address as the memory chips perceive it. Contrast that with virtual memory. Okay, roughly put, virtual memory is the stuff as it appears, if you will, to the program or the CPU that's executing the instructions on this. And I'm being hazy because essentially that's one of the features slash bugs of virtual memory. Where is this stuff? Well, it could be in, if you will, real memory chips, but sometimes it could exist elsewhere, and sometimes it might not exist at all. So again, that's what we mean by virtual memory, is something that as it appears to the CPU, and a virtual address is the number as it appears on, if you will, the address bus to the CPU. So again, physical address is the address as it appears to a memory chip, as opposed to a virtual address, that is the address as it appears to the CPU. So in other words, if I say store the string foobar in, let's say, virtual address 1000, all right, well, it's going to take that virtual address, go to the memory management thingamabob, and it's going to produce a physical address that might be 2000, and that's where it stores it in the actual underlying chips. So clear on this? So we're going to be using, again, these terms about physical versus virtual. So when we're talking about dividing physical memory, we're talking about the addresses actually as they appear on the memory chip. So again, I've got these three processes in here. And I should say, one other thing. When I'm talking about processes, and you know what? In this case, it's probably better to think about it as processes. So we're kind of running out of memory here. Because, well, we've used up everything that we already have here, which kind of leads us to one of our problems here, and that is that if we do run out of memory, we now have to do what? we have to kind of, in some way, maybe stop a program, remove it, what have you on that. Now, if you know on a real operating system, what goes on? You talk about configuring Windows with its actual swap space or Linux or what have you. So we know that there's something else that's going on here, but the problem is that requires a memory manager. So if we don't have that memory manager, if we kind of run out of physical memory, we're beginning to have problems on this. And the other thing too is, what happens if they request memory that they do not use? This happens, by the way, a lot. Well, we can try to minimize this because with a memory manager, if we run out of memory, again, this goes back to this diagram right here, there's a couple things that we can do. We can, on a real system, maybe take one of these processes or part of it and shove it out to the disk drive. And as far as the program is concerned, it doesn't know what hit it. The other thing that it could do is, let's say this process requests this amount of memory here. Rather than giving all that memory to it in the RAM chips, we're going to say, you know what, you're allowed to access that amount of memory. With me on this? You're allowed to access it, but we're not going to allocate it unless and until you actually use it. Right? And that's a neat little trick to kind of try to reduce memory footprint on this too. So again, this is some of the advantages that we can do with a memory manager. But if we have physical memory multiplexing, we're, you know what, if a process says give me memory, I got to give you memory right away. And so we've got some problems here. So far, so good? Okay. All right. Another problem here. Okay, we've got our process here. And let's say here that, let's say this process here goes away here, and we want to expand, if you will, this process here. Okay, so see this first process, let's say it died or we killed it or what have you. Anyway, it died a miserable death. And this other process over here wants some more memory. We can now kind of give it that other chunk of memory. That's great. What's the problem with this now? Not contiguous, right? Now, we as smart programmers can get around this, and yes, it does work, okay? You certainly need to sometimes deal with this, all right? But it's a pain. So to the extent possible, can we avoid this here, okay? Contiguous, it complicates process memory layout on this. So to the extent that we can avoid discontinuousness, whatever it is, okay, we want to avoid that. All right, fragmentation, another take a look at it. Basically, remember, fragmentation, it's a problem with your disk drive, it's a problem with memory, it makes things a pain, it makes things harder to program, it makes things less efficient on this. All right, process memory layout. Now, earlier I had asked, remember if we malloc something, malloc very nicely returns a pointer to where it is in memory here. That's kind of taken care of us by the library code here. Well, let's actually dig a wee bit deeper here, and where do they know where their code and data is located? So let's say that we have a program here, and we've got a little bit of an array here, and we've got, let's say, okay, where is, if you will, the code for the executable foo on this? Well, roughly put, this is all decided for us at compile time. Because if we think about it, okay, when we're running this program, presumably it's already been translated into machine executables on this. So the compiler at some point in the past had to make some decisions about which piece of executable code, which piece of data is at what point in memory on this. So that's a decision that's been made for us. So presumably we're just going to punt this whole problem to the compiler on this. And indeed, the compiler can certainly make some smart decisions. You can see, okay, locate this piece of code here or this piece of memory. And if you dig in, especially into the assembly code in OS 161, you know, the .s files, you will see a bunch of declarations. Hey, put this here. Hey, put that there. Sometimes you need to do that. Like, for example, the interrupt handler for OS 161 has to go at a very specific location that is expected by the MIPS hardware. Right? It's just a convention of the fact that we have a MIPS machine. So sometimes we have to tell the compiler that. Sometimes the compiler can figure it out on its own here. But you know what? In essence, it's something that we really want to make as simple as possible. Let's actually see why. We're talking about fragmentation, and let's talk about a couple flavors here. First off, internal fragmentation. Okay, we're talking about inside existing allocations here. Do you remember back, where were we? Right here. So let's say that we have this, right here, this allocation here. Okay, well, this process asked for and got this huge block of blue memory here. We're kind of assuming that it's using it. Well, let's kind of unassume it at this point. And let's just now kind of dig in and say that, let's say this process has used maybe this amount of memory and this amount of memory, but we've got this big wad in between that is not being used. That's an example of, if you will, internal fragmentation. There's unused memory, but it's within, if you will, kind of a particular allocation. External fragmentation, that would be an example if, let's say, in this example here, right here, okay? This, well, actually, in this case, it's a poor example because that's the only unallocated segment. But let's just say that, where is it? Right here, okay? Here is an example of external fragmentation. We've got this blue thing here, and we've got an unused segment here, and we've got an unused chunk over there. All right. And so when another program goes to request, if you will, the sum total, that program has to get, if you will, two discontiguous pieces on this. So in other words, this is, if you will, unallocated areas that are outside, if you will, particular allocations. So everyone clear on internal versus external fragmentation? The upshot is that it's fragmented. We don't like it. All right. Good example of that. Okay. Let's say that my program really does need a big contiguous, big wad of memory on this. That array might not fit into, if you will, the largest current free piece of memory, even though the total free memory might be much greater than that. Okay. This is one of the problems that's, if you will, caused by fragmentation. All right, more problems with this. So again, once again, limited to amount of physical memory. We can't push it out to disk. We also can't play tricks like not allocate it until it's actually used on this. We also have problems with, if you will, contiguousness. The fact that, yes, we can get around it, but it is sometimes a pain, and it makes programming things like handling huge arrays very difficult on this. And just in terms of fragmentation efficiency, the fact that we have to, if you will, manage discontiguous segments, it's going to be a pain. So one other thing is, until now, we talked about things that can be handled, if you will, as long as programs play nicely and the programmers know in advance kind of what's going on here. Now we're getting into the policing issue here. And we're not going to talk a lot about this today, but you want to kind of put this in the back of your brains here. Remember, what's one of the main reasons that we need an operating system here? And why do we need these levels of protection here? It's to enforce things here. In other words, I've got these allocations. Again, let's go back to something like here. Okay, let's say that this, let's say the blue process here is getting a little bit greedy and just decides to munge on the red process. What's preventing it from doing that? Okay, absent some sort of enforcement mechanism, essentially absolutely nothing. And this greediness could be caused by either maliciousness, or it could be caused by, if you will, just poor programming, a bug, if you will. So we're going to have to do something in terms of, if you will, enforcing things. Okay. One way, okay, Jeff has put this on the board here. How about this one for you? Okay. A process wants to access a memory location to, let's say, access an integer. But before it does that, it checks with the operating system. Can I access memory location 123456? Yes? Okay. Can I access memory location 123457? Yes? Okay. 123458? Yes. This sounds like a really bad plan. Okay. Extremely inefficient on that. Later on, when Jeff talks about virtualization, this is actually some of the problems with traditional virtualization. You'll get into this, because sometimes you do have to do byte-by-byte translation, and that's one of the reasons why traditional virtualization can be slow as molasses on this. In general, we don't want to do this. So we're going to have some sort of better enforcement mechanism, and again, more on that later on here. All right, now, next thing here, we're talking about reclaiming unused memory, and by that, We'll talk more about this in a minute here, but by reclaiming, what we're talking about is essentially we've got a bunch of memory that we would just rather use for better things. It's just not being used right now. Well, again, remember back to the diagram showing the processes here. Okay, if let's say I decide that there is part of a memory, let's say again, where was it again? There it is. Let's say that the middle part of this blue part, we really don't need here, so we want to give it back and be nice about it. Well, that's great, but what is that going to do? It's going to lead to yet more fragmentation on this. So again, what we're trying to say here is there's got to be a better mousetrap than the kludge of, if you will, direct physical addressing here. So let's say, what do we want here? This is kind of our wish list. This is what we want our memory manager to achieve. So up until now, we've been talking about the problems with the model of direct physical access. Now we're going to switch gears, and we're going to talk about what might be a better model here. We want a model that, first off, if a process needs memory, the operating system should be able to grant memory, okay, either statically or dynamically, okay? Number two, enforce it, okay, which is what are the enforcement mechanisms for the operating system, making sure that, remember, the blue process, if you will, doesn't eat up the red process or vice versa on that. All right, reclaim and revoke. Let me actually go down to revoke and go up. Grant means, okay, a process, if you will, says I need memory. Revoke means the kernel is saying, you know what, you're done, or in essence, we're just going to get rid of a block of memory. Distinguish this from reclaiming. What we're talking about here is, in other words, let's say that you have a process that you haven't used for a while, and it's just eating up a lot of space in the RAM chips here. And right now, the user needs to go to another website or what have you. In other words, there's a need for memory right here and now here. And we don't want to nuke the other process because we might need it later on. So what the kernel wants to do, we want a method of, if you will, reclaiming that memory, that is the stuff in the RAM chips, and use it for something else that's more pressing, but not trashing the underlying data. So clear on the distinction between, if you will, revoking and reclaiming. Revoking is, let's say, when a program is done, either it exits or it has to be killed, as opposed to reclaiming means, you know what, the program isn't necessarily done. We just really need to use this space on the physical RAM chips for something more pressing right now. All right, let's compare this page here to how we might, if you will, multiplex out a CPU. Grant, again, this is when we're scheduling a thread here. Okay, enforcement, the mechanism there, we already talked about that. Remember, I can count on there being a timer interrupt, so I know I'm going to get control. This is the essence of preemptive multitasking. There is no way that a bad process can grab more CPU time, regardless of whether or not it wants to on this. Okay, and revoke, well, the issue about that is when, let's say, a thread, let's say, is just done with its time slice and we go on to the next one. Reclaim, there is really no analog to that in terms of CPU multiplexing on this. Questions, comments? So again, with me on this, granting, enforcing, reclaiming, revoking memory. By the way, what do we mean by reclaiming? When I say, more on this in just a sec, because this is going to be part of assignment three. If I need to reclaim memory, again, I don't want to trash it. What am I probably going to do with the data that, let's say, the other process is using? Exactly, yeah. This is exactly French for swapping. Or in some way, it's going to be pushed down to some other type of backing store, as distinguished from revoking. All right. Oh, one other thing I should say. Let me digress for just a moment. Remember I was saying that there is time multiplexing and there is spatial multiplexing. And how are we multiplexing memory? We're dividing it up into smaller chunks here. Exam question. How might we, or when did we, do time multiplexing of memory? We know it's not a very good idea, but think back earlier. When did we do time multiplexing of memory? Maybe I'm dating myself. I barely remember this. Big honkin' computers. You remember batch jobs? Batch scheduling? In essence, that is, if you will, time multiplexing of memory. In other words, one job runs, it gets the entire blooming computer to itself, and then it prints out the syntax error. Then you run the next job, and it prints out the syntax error for that, etc. But in other words, it gets all of the system's resources at once. As distinguished from currently, we are, if you will, not giving any one program the entire access to memory on this. So just thought I'd digress on this. All right. Address spaces, memory management extraction here. Now, in other words, this is our ideal world. This is how we want things to appear to the user on this. So remember, by plentiful, what we're talking about is if we have, let's say, 4 gigabytes of memory, we want it to appear to the user that the user has 4 gigabytes of memory. As a matter of fact, we want Internet Explorer to have 4 gigabytes of memory. We want, who knows, your favorite torrent application to have four gigabytes of memory. We want, who knows, Spotify. All of them have 4 gigabytes of memory on this. Now, how are we going to do this with smoke and mirrors? Well, essentially, that's what a virtual memory manager does here. Contiguous. Why do we want it to be contiguous here? Remember, we were talking earlier in terms of the problems with this contiguous memory. We can get around it. You're smart programmers, but you know what? We'd rather not. It's a pain. To the extent that we can, if you will, allow user-level programmers to make the assumption that the memory that you get as a user is contiguous, it's going to make things a lot easier. Plus, the other thing, too, is if you think about it, I've glossed over something earlier. Remember when we said that we load in, let's say, who knows, Firefox at one area and then some other program, remember the red and blue processes on that? And I said, well, how do we know where that is? Well, the compiler has to make some decisions on this. Well, we're assuming that the compiler knows where this program is loaded into memory. In other words, we're assuming that the compiler knows that, let's say, the red process gets loaded into low memory and the blue process gets loaded into middle memory on this. That might not be the case. Or if it is the case, we're kind of straitjacketing ourselves going forward on this. So in other words, if we can allow the user to make the assumption that, you know what, you always, if you will, get to start things, if you will, you've got at the same place and, if you will, and a big block of memory, it's going to make life a lot easier for you on that. Now, one thing here, you're thinking, hey, wait a minute, what about these things called dynamic libraries? It's a corner case. I'm not going to get into that right now. Just suffice to say that sometimes you can't get around the fact that you need to relocate things in memory on here. But again, to the extent possible, to the extent that we can avoid dynamic relocation, it's going to make things go a lot easier. You probably all heard about dil-hel in Windows, or and if it's just like the whole problem with Dynalinks. This is part of the issue here, that we're moving things around in memory. We want to avoid that, if at all possible. So plentiful, contiguous, uniform. In other words, it always looks the same. And private. Ah, this is the other thing, too, because think about it. I said that you guys, as application programmers, get to make the assumption that, let's say, your executable segment always begins at, who knows, memory address 10 million or whatever it is. Well, that's great, right? So I, as, again, Internet Explorer, get to run things at 10 million on here, right? Or you at Safari also gets to run. What's the problem here? We've got all these user processes, and all of their executable, aka text segments, begin at the same address here. Problem? Well, actually not. That's, again, part of the magic of virtual memory. In other words, within each process, they all get essentially clones of the address space. Think about it, you're writing fork right now. Right? And remember, part of it is you need to duplicate the address space on this. Well, now we have a parent and a child, and remember we're talking about they're running essentially clones of the same program here, but they're different processes, if you will. How is that possible? Well, they both have what appears to each process, both the parent and the child, the same program running in the same apparent address. Keyword here is apparent. And Jeff's going to be getting into the details later on. It appears to the program that it appears at the same location in memory, but actually it is not in the same physical location in the memory. And that's where the virtual memory manager does its translation behind the back. And that's why something like fork works. It appears to the user that, if you will, things have been cloned. Well, again, the matrix has been cloned. But underneath that, if you will, there is some magic going on. So that's also why, if you think about it, like, if you will, the kernel stacks are not cloned when you're writing fork. So that's kind of some of the, if you will, behind the guts, what's going on. Make sense on this? Okay. So goals here, what are we looking at here? We want something that is, essentially, it appears like we get access to all of memory, and we get access, well, to all of memory, and it's contiguous. And it's the same type. It's the same location, in other words. And also, again, kind of, if you will, uniform and private are duals of each other. The fact that it's private means, if you will, I can get away with having, okay, them all start, let's say, their code segments at the same address because they're private to each process, and vice versa. If it's uniform, it had better be private. Okay, I can't have one without the other. So I hit two birds with one stone. Make sense? Yes, no. I see heads bobbing. Okay, a couple thumbs up. All right, so here we go here. Classic example. Okay, I've got the address space, the whole 64, 32 bits here, and I've got the code segment. Code is sometimes called text for whatever reason. You will hear that referred to in this class. The text segment is the code segment. Text is not ASCII. It's like the executable code. So don't ask me. Don't blame me. Anyway, so we've got a code segment, we've got a heat segment, and we've got three stacks because, if you will, let's say we have three threads running in this process here. And take a look at this. We have a very, very happy process. I get the entire 4 gigabytes, and it's the entire schmaha, and I get the same thing every time here. Really, the only fly in the ointment here is sometimes where I have to load in my dynamic libraries, but again, we're just going to modulo that for this class. Questions? Okay, layout here. Okay, take a look at this here. I always get to put my code and static variables. And again, I should say this. The specific numbers here are kind of arbitrary. The point is that the expectation remains the same here. So again, here we go. Whoops. Okay, code, again, more about this later on. The heap grows up, the stack grows down here, etc. here. But the point is that we always have these same expectations. Like in the case of OS 161, you probably have noticed that the stack starts at 7FFFFF and grows down. In the case of the executable, it's 400,000 for the text segment and grows up. Now, in terms of where do we get these numbers? In other words, where do I pull, let's say, 400,000 or whatever else it is? This is something that we've glossed over. And again, in the case of OS 161, remember, you're given the stuff that loads in the init process. But if you want to know some of the details, look into what's going in like run program and load elf here. It's kind of spelled out by, if you will, the Unix ELF convention and some parameters that are on the file that's loaded in from disk here. But in essence, what we have here is it's numbers that are specified. Put me in 400,000. Put me at 7FFF and loading down or whatever else it is. Now, take a look at this. Why not load the code at zero here? In the abstract, there really is no reason. In other words, I could very well say, you know, let's begin our text segment at location zero and go right up. Again, this is, if you will, assuming a way that there isn't some hardware problem, like some chips, let's say, they have their interrupt vectors down at location zero. But aside from that, if you will, corner case here, there's nothing in the abstract that says I can't put it at zero here. But there is a practical convention and a practical reason why we might not want to do this here. And that is, if you will, good old null pointers. Because If you think about it, we've all done it, null pointer exception, or if you are on Timberlake, segmentation fault here, because you have a pointer, you forgot to initialize it, it's defaulted to zero here, and when you try to dereference the pointer, you are trying to access memory location, zilch. So we're deliberately going to say that location zero is not allowed to a process. Why? Because we want to generate an error, because it is, ironically, a common programming mistake on this. If we didn't generate an error, the user would get, in essence, a false positive, and the user would be getting garbage data back, or worse yet, munging on existing good data on this. So we're actually going to say, you know what, we're going to leave the area at location zero and maybe a little bit above that as empty, and by empty we mean, if you will, not allowed, it's not part of the user's address space. And again, when you get into assignment 3.2, writing page tables, you'll see exactly how this works. Oh, what fun it is for you people to be the ones to generate the segmentation fault and kill off the bad process. You're on the other side of the equation rather than seeing it. So Jeff is going to be running garbage programs at you, and it's your job to catch the seg fault and kill it, because that's actually what the test will be expecting on this. Okay. Core dumped segmentation fault. Questions? Alrighty. Thanks for coming, people. More in virtual memory next time. Again, checkpoint for assignment 2. Try to be finishing up fork like now.